I will now explain how, in the wake of the digital revolution, a new kind of global fascism made its way. You have certainly heard about the revelations of Edward Snowden, and he told us a lot about mass surveillance and a few other things. However, he didn't quite tell us everything. In fact, I will show in this presentation that all the features of fascism are already there and they have been implemented in digital ways and are waiting to be used at any time. This includes mass surveillance, unethical experiments with humans, social engineering, forced conformity, propaganda, censorship, a new kind of dictatorship, a new kind of police state, the different valuation of people, the relativity of human rights, the humiliation of minorities, and even euthanasia. So we're living in a time of technological totalitarianism. In contrast to Edward Snowden, I won't show you any secret documents, but I will still reveal some important truths by connecting the dots. That means by giving you an overview and how everything belongs together to give this pattern of a new digital fascist state that has global dimensions. In Germany, of course, a lot of laws can be changed. Changes of articles of the Constitution require a majority of 2/3, but there are 2 articles that cannot be changed at all. And this is Article 1 about human dignity. And that's important because data-driven societies are not taking this into account because it's difficult to measure human dignity. So basically, data-driven societies tend to forget about human dignity, which requires that people have an opportunity to influence decisions that concern them, and that they're not being treated like animals or objects or data. Article 20 is the other article that cannot be changed. This basically says all the power, the political power, comes from the people. This is about participation. And if anybody would try to take down this democracy, then any German, in this case, would be allowed to resist such an illegitimate system. Now, I certainly don't want to ask you to take violent action or to take any unlawful action, but I'd like to say I think it's time that every one of us takes any action needed in order to stop the occurrence, the emergence, the final appearance of this already prepared fascist state. I'm starting to go through all these different features of the fascist society and talk about mass surveillance first. CIA Director Gus Hunt said some time ago, "It is really very nearly within our grasp to be able to compute on all human-generated information. You are already a walking sensor platform. You are aware of the fact that somebody can know where you are at all times because you carry a mobile device. Even if that mobile device is turned off," he said. "You know this, I hope, yes? Well, you should." And I'm now giving you an example to what extent this actually applies. I've been attending a lecture of my colleague René Algesheimer, who talked about data science. I left my computer in my office. I had my smartphone with me. Well, René Algesheimer was talking about data science as being something similar to the work of a detective. He mentioned a popular detective story series that people read when they're young, Die drei Fragezeichen, the three question marks. Now, when I returned from that lecture to my office and opened my laptop, the first thing I got to see was an ad for a book called Die drei Fragezeichen, the three question marks. Now, this was really shocking, but you know, if you search the internet, you will see similar stories. So that means all our devices are connected, and basically our devices are spying on us, and they're sending all sorts of data to information systems of all kinds. In fact, recently the German government has decided, in a more or less surprise action, a very unconventional lawmaking action, to establish mass surveillance. And it's no wonder that the ethics committee is actually warning of total surveillance. In fact, in many areas we already have total surveillance, including some traffic sections. This goes so far that even if you go 1 kilometer an hour faster than you should, you would get a traffic ticket, as you can see over here. In the meantime, we have face recognition software being used to surveil on people, so anybody moving, not even using a car, would be known. The location, the time, the people moving along with them. Now you may say, I don't worry about secret services, I have nothing to hide, but in fact, you are all being profiled and you're all being targeted, all of you. When you read newspaper articles on the internet, it turns out that everything that's of interest to you will be reported to information services that you don't know of. And that data is being collected, it's being used to basically map you, to measure you, to catalog you. And this is then being used for personalized marketing. That means to make you sensitive to the kind of marketing that they're applying to you, which is tailored to your personality. So, no wonder Eric Schmidt of Google said, "We know where you are, we know what you like. And even we can more or less know what you're thinking about." And I believe he even said, "Even before you know it." There are other companies that know what you think, such as Cambridge Analytica. They've put together different kinds of data sets, such as Facebook data with data from Axiom, that is collecting a lot of personal data about you in probably very privacy intrusive ways. They say that 300 Facebook likes basically makes you more predictable than your friends, your parents, or your partners would be able to predict you. Now, this is concerning because you would be very careful to select your friends, because you know you can be manipulated and you want to trust the people who have the possibility to manipulate you, so they wouldn't misuse this potential against you. In the meantime, however, there are companies that know you much better than your mother, than your friends, and they can manipulate you much better. And you would not even know about it because this manipulation happens subconsciously. There is a service called Crystal Knows that is analyzing everyone's personality and even displaying this information to anybody who is logging into the system. So basically, a psychological analysis being applied to hundreds of millions of people without their approval, using data that have probably been collected without your consent, and it gives pretty detailed profiles. So somebody one day brought me this profile of myself and has a lot of information in it, and I've never agreed to this, you know, and that's not all information. Here is another profile, so you can see that these profiles are very detailed in terms of personal characteristics and even your daily activity patterns, to be seen by anybody who is interested. Now, this kind of service is for free to members, you know, those who register and accept terms of use. Now, of course, there would be commercial services as well, but they would be much more powerful, right? And now think about military applications and how much more powerful they would be. It's often said that what we find in the market is 30 years late as compared to the military application. So the military is 30 years ahead. Just imagine how much data they would have about you and what they could do with it. So in fact, what they are doing is they are producing a digital double of anybody. So they're using black boxes, machine learning programs that run on the personal data that has been secretly collected about you to make these digital doubles behave in a similar way. And once these black boxes have learned to behave like you, they can make experiments with those digital doubles to find out how you can be made to buy a certain product, to assume a certain opinion, to elect a certain political party, to click a link that would download a Trojan horse to your computer, to hate your colleague or a certain religious or ethnical group. So this is pretty concerning. So these are really war games on the grand scale. And that's the true reason why there is this mass surveillance, to get all that data to produce the digital double. Just imagine what they could do with your double, you know, a lot of things that you wouldn't allow to happen to yourself, certainly. Now you might say, I am actually taking care of my personal data. I'm not exposing myself. But that's naive. You can't. Because whenever you enter the web, whenever you use the internet with a browser, there will be cookies. You'll have to accept the cookies because otherwise you won't get any service. And those cookies will basically record what you're doing, all the clicks that you're making. And that means everyone is being spied on, including politicians, so they could be blackmailed. This kind of data are really revealing everything that you can imagine. And there is an MIT project called Enigma. If I show you the webpage, then actually you might get scared, because what it's showing is that for some time, the so-called Bentham panopticon flashes up and then it disappears again. So it shows a big surveillance eye, but also you need to know that the Bentham panopticon is the model of a perfect prison where everyone can be controlled by one guard, basically. So there is a central control by everyone. So we would be the prisoners of a digital Bentham panopticon. And that's why there are books like The Circle alerting us of what is to come. I'm now getting to unethical experiments with humans. So in the 30s of last century, people made experiments with animals where they condition those animals to do certain kinds of things, and they often put them into boxes, so-called Skinner boxes, and expose them to rewards or punishment to make them do or not do certain kinds of things. Now, in fact, now we are the experimental pets. And the Skinner boxes that we have been locked into are the filter bubbles that have been built invisibly around us. These are the personalized information walls that we're exposed to. That means the Google search results, the Facebook news stream, all of that is being run by algorithms that personalize information, tailor that information to you, and make you more manipulable. In fact, Singapore is considering itself as a social laboratory. An entire city, yes, an entire country as a social laboratory, and they know how to predict how people think and behave. And how does that work? Well, basically they're applying machine learning, for example deep learning, to big data, personal data, your data in fact, and they learn how to manipulate you, how to condition you with personalized information. And that has become popular also within politics, where this is called nudging. Nobody ever told us that this nudging is using personal data, data that has been collected by spying on us, to make us vulnerable to this information stimulate, to manipulate our attention, our emotions, our opinions, our decisions, and our behavior. And this, for very good reasons, can be called mind control. It's not working perfectly, but it's working surprisingly well. It's quite impactful. And this is being used for social engineering, engineering of consent, and engineering of psychology, in particular mass psychology. So in the 30s of last century, people learned how people can be made to buy expensive products, overpriced products, like expensive cars, by having a beautiful woman sit on top of that car. But there are many tricks to influence people's emotions and thinking, and they have used these tricks to create the mass psychology of the Nazi regime that ended in World War II and the Holocaust. So it's highly dangerous. It's so dangerous because only 5% of information that's entering our brain is consciously perceived, so we would consciously act upon this, while 95% of information would subconsciously influence our feelings and decisions. And this is being used basically to program us. It's an old technique, actually. Many decades ago, they have already used it to program people. For example, in the national anthem of the United States in the 60s, they have displayed letters of the text in a certain order, not visible to the eye, but the subconsciousness would be able to read these additional messages, and these messages were trust the government, God is real, God is watching, believe in government, God, rebellion is not tolerated, trust the US government, and so on, and so on, and so on. So this is the way they're influencing our thinking and behavior. And now all of this is being personalized and therefore much more effective, because it feels like our own ideas while in fact we just have been triggered to have that idea and to take that decision. So this is social engineering. And it's based on the art of deception in many cases. It is programming people. Yes, there is a formula to govern people and societies that's being used by Google and Facebook and so on. But it also implies the end of democracy, and it raises serious questions about the ethics of influence. Cass Sunstein, one of the fathers of nudging, surprisingly now turns against this method and says we need to be very careful how we use it. For example, it can be used for forced consensus, Gleichschaltung in Germany. Now, this book by Richard Thaler has a very disturbing cover, I would say. It shows a flock of birds, and you know, there's one bird missing. It's in a different place, so that's why the title is misbehaving. You know, it's kind of suggesting everyone has a certain place in society and ought to do exactly what taught. Now, this flock of birds has the regularity of a crystal. You know, it's a military formation. This is totalitarian. However, if you watch a real flock of birds, it doesn't have that crystalline regularity. It's beautifully organized, it's very flexible and adaptive, it works very well, but it's based on self-organization. That means distributed control, not centralized control. It's just the opposite, right? But they make you believe that everyone would have to do exactly what's told, and that would be the best for society. I received an email from somebody who said, personally, I find this societal aspect interesting, to be able to create consensus, forced consensus, Gleichschaltung, among people, opinions, and so on. This is scary, you know. Look at how people behave today. It's already there. So people are being brainwashed, and this should never have happened. You know, this is really not making good use of our intelligence, of our brains. This is bad, very bad. But that's not all. There is censorship, there is propaganda, there is mass manipulation. Now, in Germany, we have a new law called Facebook Law. And it basically is a censorship law. So Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, Microsoft, you know, they signed this law. They comply with it. And while this is being presented as a measure against terrorism and hate speech, in fact, it's a measure to censor information that they don't want to spread. Here is an example. So we have tweeted something in our channel, the Future ICT channel, some time ago. And you see that Jaap van Til wrote something, but the text disappeared. And then we looked into this. It took us quite some time to find out what actually had been posted, and it turns out it was information about this more or less secretive introduction of a new surveillance law in the Bundestag, I mean, it's in the German parliament. No. So this was the sensitive information that they didn't want people to see. So this is really censorship in the very sense. And here is another example. So you see, that's a video about a talk from marketing to mind control and back. It was taken off the internet because it's claimed that it contains parts that are intellectual property of A&E. Have you ever heard of A&E? You know? I mean, apparently it has intellectual property rights or usage rights of a lot of material, but you've never heard of it, you know. This is really strange. You know, it's, you know, it looks like this is just another way to suppress thinking and talking about certain kind of things. So the use for educational purposes, for public debate, isn't possible anymore. This is really censorship in a very serious way, I believe. Now, coming from censorship to propaganda, we know that when the printing press was invented, shortly later, the 30-year war started and it cost 80 million lives. Then in the 30s of last century, the radio was used on a mass scale to promote Nazi ideology, and it ended in World War II, which cost 80 million lives. Now we have a new kind of propaganda machine, which is social bots. Now, so weaponized propaganda, AI, artificial intelligence, which knows us very well and which can manipulate us extremely well. And it's being used to manipulate elections, as Michal Kuczynski has pointed out. What has been done is psychological profiles have been created of hundreds of millions of people. So suppose you are afraid of all sorts of things, then you would be sent an email, say, or a tweet or a Facebook post or something that would say, oh, battery is on the rise and terrorism is becoming an ever bigger problem, and all that mass migration is really terrible for our society, but we will fix the problem. Now suppose you had the opposite character. They would send you completely different messages that would fit what you would like to hear, and so they would get your vote, but what they would send you would maybe be totally contradictory to what they sent to somebody else. Right? So this has nothing to do anymore with real politics. It's just making everyone vote for a certain person or party. But the politics that will finally happen will be very different, you know. This is just tricking voters, you know. This is not serious competition of ideas for voters anymore, as it's supposed to be in democracy. You know, democracy should basically be an institution that when there is a problem, people would compete with different ideas for the people's support. So the best idea should win. You know, we are far off with this. And in fact, it seems like bots have been used to influence the Brexit vote and also to influence the US election. And eventually people said bots are actually a danger for democracy, even a danger for the internet. And misinformation is really powerful. There is this kind of information wars going on between different countries, they say. Now, unfortunately, bots that lie are more useful or successful than bots that tell the truth. So we end up in a society of lies, basically. Then German politicians start to say the invasion of social bots is threatening democracy. And others even said it's a deadly danger for democracy. And finally, they wanted to do something against it, but I'm not sure what they actually did. So we ended up in a fact-free world that Barack Obama has been warning us at the end of his term. So he said, this is also a time around the world when some of the fundamental ideals of liberal democracies are under attack, And when notions of objectivity and of a free press and of facts and of evidence are trying to be undermined, or in some cases ignored entirely. And in such a climate, he said, it's not enough just to give people a megaphone. And that's why your power, he was talking to people from the press, that's why your power and your responsibility to dig and to question and to counter distortions and untruths is more important than ever. So please, everyone, dig and find the truth and tell it to the people and make sure we'll leave this terrible non-fact society, the society where alternative truths become more true than the real truths, you know. It's now possible, it turns out, to manipulate YouTube videos in real time, to change facial expressions, to change what people are saying, and it looks totally realistic. So-called cyber magicians of the secret services are able to manipulate documents online. They are, of course, actually doing this. I've seen it myself. So, for example, we always had some supplementary material on the internet for a paper on the dynamics of crowd disasters. That information was always available through the Wayback Machine, that means the Internet Archive, but suddenly one day, after that crowd disaster in Mecca in 2015, they took off the site. You know, so they blocked access of people to that information. I consider that really a serious act of trying to change historical facts. Coming to the next point, a new kind of dictatorship that they call benevolent dictatorship, you know. It is about a data-driven technocracy. And it started with Chris Anderson's dream. He said, we are experiencing the end of theory. If you just have enough data, then quantity turns into quality. The data would reveal the truth and tell us what we have to do and what we shouldn't do. And it wouldn't even need science any longer. Well, actually, most scientists don't believe this any longer, but it has been very influential on politicians. And everyone, secret services and many companies had collected as much data as they could get. The NSA, the CIA, and obviously they're collecting data also of a lot of companies. Either they know about it and cooperate, or they would just basically divert that data and copy it. And they've tried to create a crystal ball that would allow them to see anything that's happening in the world in real time, and moreover, even predict the future using predictive analytics. You know, so the military is very much interested in building such a prediction machine. And so the idea is that basically one could simulate the world, one could come up with an optimal solution, and then this optimal plan would be implemented. Like a benevolent dictator would decide that this is now to be done, and the result would be everyone would have to do exactly the thing that has been figured out to be part of that plan. You know, that would be a total dictatorship. It would be a digital command economy. Some people also say this is kind of a vice king that's data enabled, right? So if you don't need scientists anymore, if you just need a powerful data-driven AI, then basically anyone could govern the country, you know? And in the end, the kings maybe would do it. That doesn't really matter. It is a dictatorship, and no dictatorship actually is benevolent, because there's no way to figure out what would be the right objective, the goal to optimize. You know, should it be GDP per capita or sustainability? Should it be power or peace? Should it be life expectancy or its life quality? Or something else, you know, there's no science to decide it, you know. So how could you optimize the world if you cannot even determine the right goal function? And that's why we do have a pluralistic society that appreciates diversity. Diversity is actually the motor of innovation and of resilience and of collective intelligence and so on. But nevertheless, there are people who claim that the best kind of government would be a direct technocracy. You know, I don't think there is really sufficient evidence for this. In fact, those countries that are governed by people who consider themselves benevolent dictators, you know, they actually are not doing so well. You know, think of Hungary or Turkey. You know, it's not, there's no evidence. In fact, we have done database analysis which shows that democracy is not a luxury. It contributes to growth. Just China's growth is bigger than Europe's and US growth at the moment, because China still has a long way to catch up altogether, you know, on average. So it's a complete misinterpretation. But anyway, there are many people in the Silicon Valley who love disruptive innovation and even creative destruction. They say for something new to happen, you have to get rid of the old system. The question is, what are the limits, right? Could you get rid of democracy? Could you get rid of human dignity and human rights? Now, is this allowed or not? I mean, the German constitution is pretty clear about it. No, that would be considered actually terrorism, I guess, or high treason, very bad things. That's why we have to pay attention, and we need to be concerned, because some people say there are a lot of things that we'd love to do, but we cannot do because they're illegal, because there are laws that forbid those things. And people have started claiming that democracy would be an outdated technology. Democracy has created wealth, health, and happiness for billions of people all over the world, but now they say we want to do something new. And people like Tony Blair have actually questioned democracy, and so basically that created a dynamics that has really undermined the very basis of democracies. Now Google wants to reprogram the state, I mean, create an operating system for entire societies, not just for smartphones or computers. IBM is also quite ambitious with their Watson computer. And Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook, of course, has imperial ambitions. Many people have heard it. He wants to be an emperor. He wants to rule the world, you know, it's no secret, really. And there are also people in Europe that have similar dreams, you know, politicians that love China, that admire China, and say, well, we'd like to have kind of wise kings, wise business kings. In fact, Unternehmerkönig is business kings, of course, data-empowered business kings. And they want to write history, and they say China is more attractive than the rest. So it's kind of clear they want to get rid of democracy and replace it by a Chinese autocratic system. You know? Now the next point is predictive policing. So a new kind of police state where basically people would be punished already before they do a certain kind of thing, you know. It would be possible to determine in so-called soft crimes. If there is a digital double of you, it could determine whether you would demonstrate, if they would restrict freedom of press or freedom of expression or whatever, you know. They could just take you off before that law is being passed. So it's a very totalitarian kind of measure, and they would pay attention to anything that's non-typical behavior, like moaning at the airport, like laughing loudly at the airport, or combing your hair, you know. All of that seems aberrant behavior and could potentially be suspicious, you know, and it could be a sign that something is wrong with you. Maybe you're a terrorist. That's the kind of thinking. And prison sentences now basically depend on predictions about real life based on data, you know. So even though those algorithms are not very reliable and accurate, they're being used to determine people's future. Now, this is concerning, and it's getting even more concerning because the British Secret Service came up with a program called Karma Police. So they're policing not just your behavior, but even what you think and what you do and what you feel. So if you watch the wrong movies, if you listen to the wrong music, you know, it would give you minus points. So that is really terrible, and that's not the end of the entire policing action. You know, there are companies now building devices that would punish you with electroshocks if you do certain kind of things, and who knows what will happen with those RFID chips that are now being implanted into many people's hands. So a lot of people are concerned about it. We'll see. We will have to watch that very carefully, I think. Now, coming to different valuation of people. So, according to democracy, everyone should be treated equal in front of the law. But now China, and apparently also the UK and probably other countries, are introducing a citizen score. So whatever you do or don't do, if you pass a road at a red light as a pedestrian, if you pay your loan late, if you read critical news, it all would all give you minus points. If you have the wrong friends, it would give you minus points. And all that would influence the kind of jobs you can get, the interest rate that you would have to pay for your loan, and the countries that you would be able to visit. That means you would get a visa for, in the case of China. So this is really a totalitarian mechanism that turns self-conscious, responsible citizens into people who are basically slaves, who just have to do what the government demands from them. This has nothing to do with human dignity. Even if now people in China seem to find that okay, but you know, just imagine what happens when resources fall short and some people get services and medicine and stuff, and other people wouldn't get it because they're reading critical news. That's not right. So it goes further, because in democracy some people are now questioning human rights. They want to restrict human rights, you know. And of course that's the logic of data-driven societies, but this shouldn't happen, you know. This is part of a fascist kind of thinking. It doesn't mean that those people would consider themselves fascists or that we need to call them fascists, but it's an element of fascism, and that's why we need to be very careful about this. humiliation of minorities, we know that very well, you know, happens every day, becoming worse, so we can see that on the streets. And so we end up with the chapter on euthanasia and genetic selection, which was also part of fascism. So in fact now people are again talking about selection, about pre-birth genetic analysis to determine potential handicaps of babies, and so basically they would be aborted. On the other hand, babies would be genetically manipulated, so we would have kind of superior, say, races and inferior kind of people. This is something that's really part of fascist thinking, where they believed into a superior race and inferior people that would have different kind of rights. And this is becoming even more concerning because predictions of studies that were made for the Club of Rome and for other institutions say that given the limited resources of this planet, we would run pretty soon into an economic collapse, and we would also see a steep increase in the death rate. In fact, people say that anything between 3 billion and 6 billion or even more people would die, in particular if you run out of gas and oil. So we would have to learn to die, and that would create a terrible ethical dilemma. So basically, if there's not enough food for everyone, and somebody would have to die, questions come up like, should the grandma die or should the child die if one of them has to die? You know, should the famous politician die or the student, the judge or the billionaire? And these are the kind of questions, you know. And obviously, once you differentiate the value of people, you get into terrible situations. Of course, people don't want to take such kind of decision, so they would commission the decision to an artificial intelligence system that would autonomously decide who would have the right to live on and who would have to die. That's called euthanasia, and apparently people have been thinking about it, and it seems also some preparations have been made in this direction. So in conclusion, fascism has returned in the wrapping of data science and modernity, and it's a global problem. You know, fascism is back. We now see even in Germany that Mein Kampf, that populist book of Hitler, has been re-edited and distributed. It has been on the bestseller list of books. This is quite concerning, and we read now a lot again about Hitler and Nazi regimes. We see a lot of symptoms that remind of fascism in many different countries, and it seems to have become a global issue, something that has spread throughout the world, and that would be really a big danger to humanity, to societies around the globe. So I think we need to have an emergency surgery to save society, to save humanity from this dangerous fascist ideology, because otherwise we would end up again in a large-scale war. In fact, there's been a lot of talking about World War III recently. There are a lot of tensions exactly because of this, because some people claim a lot of people would have to die on this planet, and they'd like to get rid of certain kind of people, it seems, that they consider inferior and useless. And if that wouldn't happen, there would certainly be a revolution or a Holocaust, and certainly we wouldn't want to this to happen, we wouldn't want war, we wouldn't want revolution, we wouldn't want a Holocaust. And if we want to stop it from happening, then I guess we need a judgment day. So to end on a few constructive remarks, what to do now? I think it's important to confiscate cyber weapons. That means the cyber infrastructures that have been created for global surveillance and control, to ensure democratic control by the parliament of these cyber infrastructures, to ensure scientific use by leading interdisciplinary teams, ensure ethical use, including human rights, ensure transparency, cybersecurity, and prevent the misuse, have a self-destruction mechanism in case of political power grabs to ensure informational self-determination, and have opt-out mechanisms, correction mechanisms, and so on. Further on, we could create verifiable identities for algorithms and bots. We need to introduce a system of accountability and responsibility. Informational self-determination is important. We need to enforce the UN Charter of Human Rights, including privacy, that means the protection from exposure and the right to be let alone. Transparency, marking of personalized information, access to alternative versions, prevention of over-personalization, and victims should be compensated in a fair way. We've recently proposed to turn war rooms into peace rooms, and in fact the difference would be that those peace rooms would have a higher degree of transparency, a democratic framework, and they would be run by those interdisciplinary teams of scientists. There would be ethical experts, there would be a multi-perspective approach. So different values would be taken into account, and there would be a participatory opportunity for civil society by means of NGOs, citizen science, crowdsourcing, and so on. So another thing is opening up data as much as that can be done, perhaps with a delay, but the point is that we should empower people to take better decisions, to be more creative, to be more innovative, to help them coordinate each other, and to be cooperative successfully. And that in itself will create better products and businesses, better services, better neighborhoods, smarter cities, and smarter societies, and a better future. So that would enable combinatorial innovation. That means existing products and services could be combined to create new products and services. There would be an enormous innovation rate. We would, as societies, make huge progress quickly towards achieving solutions to our existential threats on this planet. We would create an information innovation production and service ecosystem, something like a sharing economy 2.0, where everyone can contribute with ideas, with products, services, and with talents and resources. Now, I think this is really important. Everyone should have opportunities to contribute, to unfold their talents, and we should have a system where people can control the use of their data through personal data stores, where they can decide who could use personal data for what purpose, for what time period, and how much money they would get for this. They should certainly be fairly compensated for providing their data. And in fact, this administration of their data could be supported by AI systems that learn your personal preferences, how your personal data should be used, by whom, for what, and so on. So this would establish a trust-based information society. So please help us succeed to get on a better track into a better future, because we'd like anything to happen but a global fascism that would kill more or less 3 billion people.